everyone. On behalf of ADI Hyderabad, we welcome you to Design Stories, a series of webinars and live events aimed at discovering a successful designer and engaging with them to discuss their bittersweet journeys towards being called successful. ADI is a network representing the professional interests of the Indian design community, creating a meaningful interface between design professionals, people as users, the industry, education institutions, students, and policymakers. My name is Akhil Karanam. I am the head of industry outreach at ADI Hyderabad and your host for today. Before we start today's session, we'd like all of you to, Anshu, do we have a poll ready? Okay. So our guests for today are Santosh Kochar Lagota, Nakul Latkar, and Vidyadhar Bhandare, the founders of Earth & Tunes. Founded by the alumni of National Institute of Design Ahmedabad, Earth & Tunes is a social enterprise trying to build a better India for the future. It is presently being incubated by the Rural Technology and Business Incubator at IIT Madras. The co-founders had pursued masters in transportation and automobile design at NIT Gandhinagar and had completed their undergraduate in engineering. Prior to starting Earth & Tunes, the team had worked in various fields ranging from electric vehicles, mobility for the disabled, Indian railways, to marketing and man management in oil marketing giants. Welcome to ADI Hyderabad Design Stories, guys. So tell me, guys, why did you, from the myriad of problems that the farmers of our country face from day to day, choose to address the problem of a farmer's footwear first and foremost? Why and how did this journey start?
Sure. Firstly, thank you, ADI, for inviting us to talk on this prestigious platform. It's truly an honor. And to answer your question, I believe that was the reason we actually made up a whole presentation, and we wanted to share the whole journey with you, because generally it is not very obvious that why would you want to actually make footwear when there are other issues which are plaguing farmers. So hopefully I think our presentation would answer this question. And if it's okay, do you want me to start?
Please do. We are raring to go. Yeah.
I hope my screen is visible.
Yes.
Right. Good evening, everyone. Thanks, Akhil, for the introduction. So we are Earth & Tunes Design. Just to give you a brief snapshot, what we are doing is we are trying to make footwear for India. And when it means India, we are covering both rural and urban India. One of our main range of footwear is actually for the Indian farmers, which we have made from indigenous desi wool. How did we arrive at this? I'll just go through our presentation. So one of the first questions we generally get asked is, your transportation designers, why are you trying to make footwear? And that is one of the, indirectly that would answer why actually we started Earth & Tunes. So prior to just starting Earth & Tunes, the three of us worked on a wheelchair project as part of our graduation thesis. And although transportation in NID has been more about the stylistic things, we realized the potential of design thinking when we were actually making this wheelchair and how it could actually impact Indians per se. And how we could come up with something which is completely new and which solves the problem precisely which Indians are facing. During this research, we also realized that most of the stuff we find in India is actually Western. And we generally find the downgraded versions of it. So we also, during this journey, we were trying to understand and define what truly Indian design is and whether you can actually come up with something without no influences from the West at all. So, just to give you an idea, this is actually a three-wheeled wheelchair which we designed for a startup called Indian Designs. The startup was also incubated by IIT Madras, and these people they have started production just this year, and the wheelchair is doing quite well actually. And this was done from ground up using only design thinking principles. The next thing is actually after this wheelchair project, three of us came together in about 2018. And we decided we'll just do something for rural India. We did not decide it will be footwear or what it will be. But one good thing we did is, as design thinking says, that we did not sit at our home and just go through the articles to understand what the problem is, but we went into the field. So our first part of the journey to cover was how can we wanted to cover the whole supply chain from the seed, sowing of the seed until the food actually ends up in your plate. So what we call as from farmer to food actually. So we went through the whole supply chain. So we started off mainly in Nanded, which is actually Nakul's hometown. And we picked up summers because we there's a notion generally that the farmers face a lot of difficulties in summer. So we started off, we would go to fields, set out in the morning and just talk to them. And there wasn't any specific agenda. It was just about understanding, just having a good chat with them. We would also try out things like, you know, as an example here of driving the tractor, just to understand, you know, what are the nuances of it and, you know, how difficult it is. Then we also went to the next part, you know, after the harvest happens, there's a whole other supply chain, or there's a whole, you could say like an economy which happens is, you know, from storing grains to the APMC. For people who might not be doing what an APMC is, Agricultural Producing Marketing Committee, it has been in the news recently due to the farm laws as well. We generally keep listening to this problem of middlemen, and we actually did get to see it in action, where there was a lot of, you could say, disparity and cheating happening on farmers. Other than that, we also visited godowns. We tried to understand how the logistics happened. A lot of interesting insights also came across there. Like, you know, there's a lot of food wastage which happens during storage. Generally, the farmer doesn't get his share of money as soon as he gives his farmer produce. He has to wait for like a month or so. During this time, when we were trying to understand the whole cycle, this whole journey took about, I think, 6 to 7 months. And we also came across similar people who were doing much more greater things than what we were doing. And we were truly overwhelmed when we saw these kind of activities happening. One was our interaction with Mr. Subhash Palekar, who is actually one of the leading natural farming promoters in India. He's in fact advising the government of India as well. We were lucky enough to attend one of his sessions. And apart from that, we also took part what was called as a run, which was or a initiative which was being taken by Pani Foundation. Pani Foundation is actually an organization run by Mr. Amir Khan, where he was trying to address the issue of drought in rural Maharashtra by encouraging the villagers to take part in activities which can help store rainwater. So these kind of things actually encouraged us more and to come up with something which can actually make an impact. From this, we were always helped by the local people. They were always willing to share their experiences with us, and all of this experience was truly eye-opening for us. So we came back after this research and we started collating what are all the problem statements we came across. Initially, we zeroed in on 20 problems. From the 20, we picked up 5, which are actually a part of what Earthen Tunes is, and it's part of our timeline for the next 10 years. And the first problem we wanted to address is the problem of farmers walking barefoot. Now, generally, there is a romantic notion with people walking barefoot. People say that you're in touch with Mother Earth. It's good for the health. That is actually not true in case of farmers. Probably it was a few decades ago, but right now the soil conditions and ecological conditions do more harm than good for the farmers. Just to give you an idea, this is a very common site for any rural field we look at. A lot of cracks. You will also find fungal infections and in some cases snake bites as well. And why does this happen is actually farming is a very unique kind of a condition which is man-made. It is not natural. You are creating artificial conditions so that you can grow food. Now, this actually presents a different kind of challenges. And unfortunately, there is no solution in the market for this. Generally, people say, why don't they use gum boots? Why don't they use something like woodland? What we need to understand is all these are Western concepts which we are trying to impose here. Boots, as an example, is actually a very flawed product which is trying to be pushed in Indian markets. And what finally happens is they end up not wearing anything. So in both these conditions, you actually cannot see their feet, but they are actually barefoot. Just to give you an idea, this is an organically grown vegetable farm. And a high chance of finding snakes or some sort of sharp objects is very high here. So we just did not see this. We also tried to experience this firsthand. So what we did is we would pick a farm and we would walk we bought all the footwear that is available in the rural markets, which is available for the farmers, and we tried and we wore them by ourselves, and we tried to understand what these people go through. So one is obviously barefoot. Next is we also bought the traditional slippers that they have, then the other types of sandals, open type footwear, and we tried walking in these conditions. And we deliberately picked up monsoon in a monsoon season to test this in an area called Kolhapur, again, which is hometown of Vidyadhar, where there's a lot of black soil. Black soil is actually one of the most challenging conditions for any farmer to work in, because this is what happens. It starts accumulating. So we tried out and we realized that there are a lot of flaws for this. So we again came back after the research. We listed out 7 to 8 points, which we thought were very essential and that our footwear should address this. Now, we know what the requirement is. Now we have to find a solution. And we directly did not jump to the conclusion that it will be a rubber-based footwear. But we thought, you know, India has such a wealth of natural fibers. Why not we understand if we can solve this problem with some sort of natural fiber itself. So our first part of this, we started our journey again in Wardha, where we collaborated with an NGO called Dharamitra. They were kind enough to give us their facility, and we tried out footwear with jute fiber, banana fiber, and paper. Cotton fiber. And we tried, these were our very initial footwear prototypes which we made. So these had some very interesting properties, these footwear, but they weren't reaching the 6 or 7 parameters we were looking for in a footwear. So we just made prototypes and then we moved on. Our next part of the journey is we went to Kerala. Again, we got a chance to work with an NGO called Kids, which is based in a place called Kottapuram. We tried out footwear with screw pine water hyacinth in this place. Interesting, this place is actually run by a local church which supports single widowed women. And we were very lucky to actually work with them. This was also a part where we were trying to co-fabricate the footwear with the women there. We also came across an interesting museum in this Kottapuram, which had a wealth of natural fibers and different types of weaves. Unfortunately, Kids has stopped producing these weaves because of lack of demand. In case any of you visit Kottapuram, you should visit this museum. It's an amazing place to be there. Unfortunately, it's not getting enough importance in press that it needs. After that, we worked with another organization called CCRI, which is Central Coir Research Institutes in Alappi. We worked in coir there, and also again a variation of water hyacinth and sisal fiber as well. This is the footwear we had come up with after working with them. The left one is made from screw pine and coir, and the right one is made from coir fabric. Again, these were good footwear to work. They felt great to wear, but again, they weren't meeting our requirements of making a footwear for farmers. So overall, through all this journey, we experimented close to 14 to 15 fibers until someone somewhere in Nagpur told us there is this elusive wool which has this properties which we were looking for. So this is honestly, it was magic when we first saw it. Just to give you a demonstration of it, I'd like to play a video.
It's not playing over here.
It's not playing?
No.
Oh, okay. Okay.
One second. Is it playing at your end,
Satosh? I think I shared the wrong screen. Just a second.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Is it playing now?
No.
No?
No. I think there's a little lag. I think it should start playing.
I'm sorry. Just, Is it playing now?
No, we are actually able to see your screen, but not the video.
not sure why that is happening. It's not even showing the video for me. I'm not sure why.
Can one of you, Vidyadhar or Nakul, play the video from your end, maybe? If you have the video with you.
Yeah. Okay. Is it visible now?
Can you just play it? I think it'll be.
Yeah, it's visible. You can play it.
Yeah. No. So one of the main challenges we had.
Can we have the video played probably towards the end? Because.
Okay. You want. No, actually, the main thing I wanted to show there was one of the main challenges we were facing with any natural fiber is when it comes to water resistance.
Okay.
And this material was truly fascinating in the sense that it doesn't allow water to stay. At all, and we tried it by putting it on our heads, and this is like a demonstration of how water repellent it is. And then we realized that actually the pastoral community who make these wool blankets, they a typical wool blanket actually lasts for 20 to 25 years, and they use it throughout the year, which is something which actually was very fascinating for us, and that's the reason we went to actually check this out, and. Just during this time, we also tried understanding the other part of wool economy as well. You know, where it is sheared from, you know, what is the quality of the fleece. And we also came across other practices of how the whole wool blanket is made. And a lot of interesting things came across. One thing is wool economy is actually one of the main source of income for the pastoral community. There are... India actually has 4 to 5 types of indigenous wool, and it is mainly reared by specific pastoral communities. So the area where we did our research was mainly in the Deccan region, in Deccan Plateau, which is Karnataka, Telangana, such things. It employs both the men and women of the pastoral community, interestingly, this economy. For example, this wool is sheared by a specific community called Katragars. Then it is carded and spun by the women of the home. And then it is woven by the men. Typically, a whole blanket takes a month to be made, and just the weaving process takes 4 to 5 days. And interestingly, everything that is used in this process is eco-friendly. And the looms that they use are actually one of the oldest forms of pit looms in the world, probably. And these are the, on the right side is actually the tools they use. The top one is for the shearing. Mm-hmm. And the bottom one is a brush that is used to apply a specific tamarind paste to increase the to decrease the coarseness of the wool and to increase its water resistance. But unfortunately, this economy is right now on the decline because these blankets, because of their coarseness, are being replaced by the plastic alternatives. And what used to be a very thriving market in a place in Karnataka is dwindling quite fast. In fact, the average age of the weavers right now is 60 years, and no one is actually taking up this craft. So we felt there's a possible, this is again just a demonstration of the state that the craft is in. This is in fact a carding machine which was installed by the government probably 20 years ago. It's in a very bad state of decay because this is hardly used for 3 months in the year. Mm-hmm. So we felt there's a possible synergy here that there is a material which addresses our need and probably when we are using this material to make the shoe, we could also increase the demand for the material and there is a chance that the weavers might get benefited. So this was at a very initial stage when we started off this idea.
Right.
And then the challenge was actually to take this material and to make a shoe out of it. This is where we faced a lot of difficulties because most of the people we met, even if they were artisans, we researched at least 4 to 5 markets ranging from Hyderabad, Mumbai, Ambur, Chennai, all this to understand if anyone is willing to make. But none of them were willing to work in this kind of material because it's a fabric. It actually sheds, and people would say reasons such as, my sewing machine would get jammed and such things. And we also realized that normal apparel weavers were not apparel tailors were not willing to work because we realized that there's a taboo related to manufacturing footwear. So to overcome this, there's only one thing we could do. We bought a sewing machine by ourselves and we learned stitching and we started making prototypes. In fact, not me, but more my co-founders Nakul and Vidyadhar. Nakul had learned how to do crochet and he knit this shoe. Vidyadhar had become an expert in stitching. And all the prototypes you actually see here were made by us. And
interesting.
In fact, this is the last prototype which we picked up to do a pilot testing for our shoe. But we did not give up in the sense that we wanted to still check whether we can get this manufactured. One of the ideas we tried out is, can we approach SHGs, women's self-help groups? This is actually, we work with SHGs in both Chennai and Hyderabad. This is an SHG in Chennai. And they were actually able to make the shoe in a day, in fact, a pair of the shoe. And all this, none of us were actually fluent in Tamil, but we were able to communicate our design. And we were able to come up with a design which is easily understandable, where we used things like symmetry, easy to mark. We gave them all the tools that they required, and they were able to make the shoe in a day. This was encouraging, but we felt this is not what we could take for a large scale production. So this idea is still part of Earthentune's timeline, which we would like to pick up later. But this was an interesting observation. Then later on, IIT Madras approached us. In fact, sorry, we approached IIT Madras and we asked them if they could fund us and incubate us. They told they liked the idea, but they told they were apprehensive about it and they wanted us to prove the viability of the idea. So they told us to do a pilot for it. They told us at least to sell a few pairs and show us that this has market viability, and then we'll provide you IIT incubation. So we made 30 pairs from a place called Ambur. We got them manufactured by requesting one of the local manufacturers, and we set out. Again, we went to Maharashtra and a few places in Telangana. We tried to sell the shoes directly to the farmers, and we also tried to understand the feedback that they had. And the whole pilot was not done for free. We would charge at least some token money from them so that they would value the product. And here we tried out different types of wool as well. We tried out 100% wool. We also tried out blended wool. And there were a lot of interesting insights which I'd come across. So this is just a snapshot of different conditions that we tried out in. We also found that the women were a major part of the labor, and they also loved our shoes. In fact, a lot of them would recognize this material as gongadi or the wool blanket, and they themselves would encourage other people around them to wear our shoe. This is just the people whom we gave our shoes to. and then after this, our endeavor was to associate ourselves with something like IIT, because a lot of new doors would open when we associate with them, and that luckily happened. IIT liked the results that we got from the pilot. We piloted actually 30 shoes, and 29 of them got sold out in 2 to 3 weeks, and people were willing to pay the money we were asking for. And so we were lucky enough to be incubated by IIT. They gave us a lot of platform, good platform. We were able to display our products at various forums, and we got a lot of interesting feedback. Interestingly, at the same time, we were also selected as one of the finalists for Lexus Design Award in 2019-20. And we were lucky enough that our product was also displayed at the Delhi International Airport, the bottom right one. And finally, after a lot of iterations, this is the shoe that we are presently making. This is the shoe we'll be marketing. We have two ranges now. We have one range for urban India, which is made from 100% wool, which is priced at a higher price. And we have one for rural India, where the design is similar, but the upper material changes. We have gone with a wool blend for rural India because rural India required more strength. 100% wool was failing at a few points. But interestingly, the blended blankets are also being made by artisans from rural India itself, and we are sourcing those blankets as well from them. The next idea we are also working on is to come up with a snake bite shoe. We are presently actually working with Madras Crocodile Trust in Chennai, which is also known as Snake Park. They are one of the most forefront of herpetologists in India. And they liked our idea, and they also are going to provide us the testing facilities to test our shoe. Parallelly also, we did not want to just discount what is happening in traditional India in terms of snake bite. So we also tried to understand the traditional methods, like we met a few tantrics and healers, but we did not find anything encouraging in that direction. So the final solution we have come up with is this shoe. This is presently in testing phase, and this is a shoe that we'll be making for snake bite protection. This is up till the ankles. This is much more better than the boot that is available right now, because it is much lighter, breathable, and it is more closer to your profile of your feet, unlike the boots. And it hopefully, at least the initial trials seem very positive, and it should provide 100% snake bite protection. If it does, it will be probably India's first footwear to do so. And next part is mainly about us and the people who have helped us in our journey. Although we have been told a lot of times that this is a stupid idea to go after and such things, we weren't just the three idiots who were involved in this. There were a lot of other people who helped us out. For example, our batchmates from NID, Mr. Anand, Mr. Pranav, they actually sacrificed their time to come along with us on our journeys, which actually did not have any specific agenda, but just exploring the place and the fibers there. This is Mr. Kanna. He is from an organization called CFP, Center for Pastoralism. He was very, very pivotal in us understanding the wool economy. This is Mr. Chaitanya Solanki. He actually has done all the beautiful photo shoots of our products until now. And also he has given us a lot of valuable feedback. And also I think we are lucky as a team that we were friends before we started this firm, and it is truly encouraging that every morning we get up, we do something that we love with people that we are very comfortable with, and that has also helped us a lot in coming this long. Apart from that, we have also taken the help of a lot of organizations like CFP, Core Board, Dharamitra, Pioli, a few of the names that I have mentioned. So yes, that is from us. Sorry if I've taken up
No. I think this is pretty awesome, guys. I'm glad that you guys stuck to your gut and didn't listen to what the naysayers had to say about going ahead with your project. Thank you. And given that you guys just started in 2018 and you had about 1.5 years before the pandemic struck, I think yes. whatever you've done till then, I think it is quite commendable.
Thank you.
So. So I had a few questions for you guys.
Sure.
One of the first questions was, how is the usage of Dakini wool more organic in application, you know, from other protective shoes that workers use, say, in a construction site? Mm-hmm. I think you've already answered this question, but a slight extension to that would be, do you think these shoes can have an application outside of a farm environment too?
Absolutely. Actually, we have been told, and when we were talking to farmers, there were a lot of other allied activities, people around who would come to us asking for these shoes. A good example is actually construction workers. In fact, in Vatar, there were people who approached us saying that we want to use these shoes. So I think there is an application for this outside farming also, absolutely. But we haven't tested it out, but I'm pretty sure it will work.
Right. Also, guys, I read somewhere that the first pilot stock of shoes were made by weavers, and then the next batch was made by leather experts. So what changed, and did it bring in any sort of a change in the way the shoes were made? Or
It wasn't absolutely, because as I mentioned earlier, this fabric is new. Mm-hmm. And no one were willing to work, although we tried various stages of production from different people. For example, we approached cobblers also, but the quality wasn't good enough. We approached SHGs who had a bit of experience of footwear, but then again, the quality wasn't enough. Mm-hmm. Then we went to Ambur, where it is a lot of red tape, in the sense that they will not even talk to you, because you are just a guy who is hardly wanting to make 30 pairs. Mm-hmm. So these kind of problems were always there. But again, we never gave up. We were always exploring places. The final shoe that we are making actually is made in Agra.
Okay.
Where the expertise is there, and honestly, they were just good people who are willing to help us. Because the person who's helping us manufacture now also, he doesn't have any need to do it. But just because he I don't know, he related to the idea, he liked that three of us were very ziddy about it, and he said, okay, I'll make it for you. And honestly, his quality has been far superior than anything we have come up with.
I think there's always someone to help if you're willing to just take a plunge, Santosh.
Absolutely. I mean, it was very overwhelming sometimes that, help comes from places you never expected it.
Absolutely. So why do you think no one else came up with this idea of using Dakini wool to make shoes earlier? I mean, it was always available and has been in used by shepherds and village folk for centuries, right?
Right.
So
I'm really not sure. It was actually baffling to us as well. How can we as a nation miss on such a treasure of a material? I'm not sure. There have been people who have tried to increase the income for the weavers by marketing the Deccani wool or the blankets more, but probably this kind of approach wasn't there before. I'm not sure. At least after this, people start looking at this material, hopefully, and they find more applications to it.
Right. So do you think it would be safe to claim that you're the pioneers in whatever you're doing right now?
I don't know, but maybe. We'll only know once we probably apply for a patent, I guess. So, yeah. Hello.
I think it's screen froze.
So while Akhil returns, I have a question in the chat box. Okay, Akhil is back. Akhil, you were frozen.
Oh, I didn't know that. Sorry.
So yeah. Akhil, go ahead.
Yeah. So with veganism becoming a very fast growing trend and coming to practice in the Nordic countries, mm-hmm. most parts of Europe, Australia, and a considerably good part of India.
Right.
Do you have any plans for vegan alternatives for your flagship product, the shoes, and others in the pipeline, if any?
Absolutely.
I am a vegan myself, but not completely. With...
Sorry about that. I think
no problem.
He has an
issue. Yeah, I'll try answering that question. One good thing when we did all this material research, these 15 natural fibers we've researched, we found a lot of alternative directions which we could take as a project in themselves in future. For example, we tried out to make a sole design from coir, which had a lot of interesting applications, but we had to stop it at that point of time because of lack of funds. So I think most of the fibers that we researched have a lot of possibilities. In fact, this croupine footwear that we showed you, that has probably applications in the hospitality industry. So yes, I feel there's a lot of scope.
There is a question in the chat box. Right. How do the shoes respond to slush and wet mud? Doesn't it make shoe maintenance an additional daily chore and cumbersome? And don't all pebbles get into the shoe?
Yes. So one thing what we have done is we have a double weave structure as of now. So the weaving is quite tight. So the chance of any small particles going inside is quite less. Secondly, wool itself has anti-dust properties. It's dust repellent. So it doesn't, you would say, attract so much mud. And let us say, even if it does, you just put it on a running water, which is commonly found in most of the farm conditions, and it just cleans off by itself. Second thing, which we did not mention probably before, is actually our shoe can be worn sock free, which is one of the main requirements for rural population. So at least from our testing that we have done, we did not find the cleaning to be cumbersome. And also just another point to add, one of the main challenges when people walk in slush is the footwear get effect in the sense that the upper gets detached from the sole. So we have gone with a very robust molded shoe construction, which is the strongest form of bonding. And to just check this, we also got our shoe lab tested at CLRI, which is Central Leather Research Institute. according to the Satra standards, and our shoe are known to are with high performance foot shoes. That is the kind of bonding we were able to achieve in the shoe construction. I hope that answers your question.
Anshu, am I still frozen?
No, you are fine. You are here.
Okay. Great. My next question was, since farming is mostly based out of villages, most farmers who work in the fields are not on the interwebs. So what is your approach to market and distribute your product to your target audiences? I mean, how do you plan to do that?
That's a great question. Our initial idea was that we'll go through the normal retail route, is you market your product or you sell your product to the local distributors and retailers. But the problem with that is there's no way you can ensure that your footwear only reaches the farmers.
Right.
So what we are doing is we are collaborating with companies such as Samunnati and a lot of other companies which have approached us, who are directly marketing other products to farmers, and they're working with FPOs. FPOs is what is known as farmer produce organizations. It's a large number of farmers who come together to form a company. So our idea is to market directly to them, so that we'll also be able to save up a lot on our margins, and we'll be able to give the footwear to the farmer at a much lesser price. Because if you go through the conventional retail route, you'll have to give in money at every stage to each right. one in the supply chain. So yes, we are targeting FPOs.
Right. Yeah, good. Glad that you mentioned Samunnati. I think Samunnati's promoter is one of my uncles.
Oh,
yeah. Mr. Anil.
Okay. We're lucky enough to talk to Anil sir also.
How affordable are your shoes for the average farm?
Right. So our shoes right now are priced at $750 plus shipping. Which is per se not what you would say is affordable, but what we feel is once the farmer uses the shoe and he sees the construction, I think he would probably realize why the value in it. The construction is actually on par with some of the best shoes that you can find in the market. And secondly, we feel that not all farmers cannot afford this. Just like how urban population has different strata of who can afford, we feel there's the same possibility in rural India also. We have seen this happening firsthand, that if you're able to show value to them in the product, they are willing to pay. So I think our endeavor will be to show value and how it's beneficial.
Exactly. Right. So Namisha here asks, good to see the material explorations. Did you explore discarded tires? Some farmers use buckets made of these to carry cow dung.
Absolutely. We did also, in fact, the pilot that we had used, the shoe that we had used for the pilot had discarded rubber tubes. The problem with why we did not go for it in large quantities is because the availability of it. It is difficult to find tubes of similar quality in large numbers. At least at that point of time, it was slightly difficult. But we are always open. In fact, we will again start the exercise of how we can make our shoe much more green. So that's always in pipeline.
Right. So is this the only product that you have at the moment, or are there other variants or other shoes that are that you're promoting for different applications in the real world?
As of now, we have only two ranges which we are marketing. One is the urban one. Urban one has two variants. We are using one wool from Deccani region and one wool from Uttarakhand. So we have two variants there. And one, of course, is the farmer one. The next range we are going to make is for just targeted exclusively at women, because a lot of interest has been shown in our footwear from women. So we are going to try out interesting natural dyes, which is part of our next try. Also, we feel we just touched the surface of different types of weaves. We feel there's a whole wealth of different types of weaves that we can try out. So yes, a lot of interesting possibilities in the future. And of course, you would have seen in our presentation that snake bite footwear is also in the pipeline. So yes.
at who it...
Sorry, Akhil.
So there's a question in the chat box. Good to see the material exploration.
Right.
Did you explore discarded tires? Some farmers use buckets made of these to carry cow dung.
Yes, ma'am. I just answered that question. Yes.
Okay. That's been answered. Yeah. So there's another question. Namisha asks again. It says, any other interesting problems you came across which you intend to solve other than snake bite prevention shoes?
Only in terms of footwear or generally the problems that farmers face?
So generally, because that was anyway going to be my next question as well.
Oh, absolutely. There are a lot of potential. As I said, our next five projects are not footwear related per se. So we are looking at other ideas like, can we come up with an alternative to the tractor is one we are looking at. Second thing is, we are seeing if we can make some improvements in packaging, because a lot of wastage happens every year in terms of storage and transportation of farm produce. But we have traditionally been only using gunny sacks. So there are a lot of problems.
Right.
We have made a list of. Hopefully we find the time and the money to do it in the future. So yes.
I wish you do find the funds.
Thank you.
Yeah. So Smriti Agarwal asks, that's awesome. And I'm hoping that you would eventually make shoes conducive for trekking and hiking. Is that an area that you're exploring too?
Truth be told, we are more of a problem solving for a specific community rather than making good footwear, in the sense that we are not shoe designers per se. We only got in here because the research told us that you need to make footwear for farmers.
Right.
As I mentioned earlier, we never started off saying that we will make footwear for farmers, but it is something that the research guided us to. So let us say somewhere in the future, if we come across a problem statement, which again says that you need to make shoes for a specific target audience, we are up for it.
Right. So, talking to the audience here, would you have any questions that you would want to ask the trio? Audience, please key in your questions, please. So in the meanwhile, when do you plan to launch Santosh, Vidya and Nakul?
We were supposed to launch now, but COVID has stalled our plans in a very bad manner.
Okay.
We are trying to work out because our production. So we are going to start taking pre-orders this week.
Okay.
Hopefully, probably in the next couple of days. We are working on the website. It's almost done.
Okay.
We are very close to launching. But the actual delivery of products we are expecting to happen somewhere in July end to August. This is because of the COVID situation. We are trying our best. Factories are still closed, or you know, they're just opening up. There's lack of labor, vaccinations and such things. So we are trying our best. Hopefully, finger crossed, July.
Right. One more question that I wanted to ask you was, do you think the farmer variant of the shoe, it'll suffice to help out all terrains of farms?
No, absolutely not. That's a very good question, actually. This is just a small step in that direction.
Okay.
As I said, what we see here is a huge diversity of farm conditions and terrain and weather conditions. Mm-hmm. And on the left, what we see is a large wealth of weaves and materials.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure you can match all of them somewhere.
Right.
Like this weave will work in this structure, this terrain, this weave will work in this terrain. So in the ideal utopian way is the weavers get enough work and the farmers have enough footwear.
Interesting. Yeah. There's a lot of match the following that you guys are going to have to do.
Yes. And hopefully that seeing us, at least few other people also enter this field. There is something they can also do.
I hope so too. So Namisha here asks, would you look get teaching folks in the rural communities so they can produce it locally?
Yes, absolutely. That's a very good question. Our final aim is to come up with a circular economy for shoes. That is the reason we tried making the shoes with SHG in the first place. We wanted to see how easy it is for the shoe to be replicated so that we teach people so that they can source the material locally and they themselves make the shoe. And Earthen Tunes will only have like just a say in terms of training and such things. So yes, it is possible. But it takes time. That's the only thing.
Right. So Namisha here has another interesting question. She says, if one were to take your shoes in a barter system, what would you take in exchange for a pair of your shoes?
Okay. Because it's mango season, I think it will be some good amount of mangoes. I don't know. Maybe Vidyadhar and Nakul could answer. That's an interesting question.
It'll be great to interact with them because absolutely. They must be knowing some another fiber.
Yes.
Or an idea.
Actually, we are dying to, you know, start our sale on ground with the farmers, you know, visiting different villages and all. So it's like, you know, flashback to where we started and where we are selling it. But because of this pandemic, we are not able to do that. But right. We had a lot of things in our mind, you know, which we wanted, you know, in a dying need to do those things. And we waited for a certain amount of time, but, you know, this COVID, things lagged. But anyway, whenever we get the time, we'll go back to the fields again and interact with the people, especially the farmers, and see how it, you know, their reaction, how they see it now.
Right. So any other questions from the audiences? Namisha says, awesome. Thanks so much for answering all your questions. And she says, your work is really inspiring.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. I thank you for the kind words. Thank you.
Waiting for a few more questions from the audience.
Actually, truth be told, one of the most gratifying part of our work is actually seeing the emotion of the farmers once they use our products, because I feel that they get impacted when we tell that we designed something for them, which I think is rare. We specifically go over them and tell them this is made for you. You try it out. And one also other thing we realized is, although this community hasn't asked us, people ask, why are you making such trendy shoes for farmers? So we have a counter question for them saying, why don't farmers deserve fashion? Or don't farmers need something which looks beautiful? So a lot of people, you know, we keep meeting investors and all. They have a very monolithic view of what rural India is. All of them are poor. All of them are in tattered clothes and none of them wear anything beautiful. But truth be told, we have seen more aesthetic sense in rural India than urban. So yeah, in exchange, we don't need any mangoes, but I think if someday a farmer comes and says to us that your shoe helped me improve my health or it protected me from a snake bite, I think that is the biggest compliment we can get. I think everything else would be secondary.
Very intent. So Ankana says, very inspiring work. Kudos to the team, Earthen Tunes.
Thank you, Ankana. Thank you.
Okay, Vinay Bhaskar here has a question. He asks, are they looking for any agencies to work on GTM strategy?
Yes, as I mentioned, for
Vinay,
for rural, as we are working with companies such as Samunnati to directly reach out to the farmers. And one interesting thing which has come about in the last month is actually since we have our shoe got a bit of press, that a lot of farmers have been calling us directly. And they are also checking out the website, which is something we did not expect. Again, that is that's a ignorance from our end. We thought all farmers are not tech savvy. So that's a wrong assumption. they are tech savvy. In fact, they are more proactive. We have, in fact, 80% of the inquiries we got are from far from rural India, and are directly from farmers. So yes, we are also learning new ways. So initially, our idea was that we will not put our farmer shoes on e-commerce at all. But since last 1 month, we have changed that. We are going to retail the farmer shoes through e-commerce as well.
That's an interesting statistic coming from you.
So
that 80% of the traffic is coming from the rural part of the country.
Yes, and that also fortified our understanding that there is a need. For example, we got inquiries from Himachal Pradesh, from Rajasthan, where we didn't even go for the research. So there is a need. People are looking for footwear. So that was very encouraging for us.
Right. So Vikas Sethi asks, inspiring presentation.
Do you have any suggestions for designers who wish to venture into design for rural India? One thing we would like to tell for hopefully people who are inspired from our work is very few of what happens in our villages is documented. And you can get a lot of ideas if you actually go and talk to them and visit them. So our suggestion is don't read any of the literature that is available on the net. You just go and spend time in the villages. There are a lot of interesting innovations that happens. And although the West has been harping about eco-friendly sustainability, this has always been a part of our culture. You don't need to go and tell me it needs to be sustainable. That's the only way he knows how to weave a blanket. So there are a lot of practices you can take from them and inculcate in your field of design, whatever it is. So there's a lot more to learn. And one advice is just go and spend some time in villages. That's where true real India is.
Just one addition to what Santosh said. A lot of people say there are no opportunities or no business or something like that. But you just leave home and, you know, interact with the people. There are so much opportunities. And I feel very heartfelt when, you know, we came to know about some truth, like, you know, these are the last generation of people who are weaving that Gongadi. And since the Gongadi is not getting the market, their children don't want to pick it up. Same thing is happening with farming as well. People are not finding any business or any money, and they are looking for other jobs. Like, so if you want to, you know, go and look for the opportunities, go right now. Don't, you know, waste your time and try to grab as much of a knowledge as there, you know, because our past generation have worked really hard, you know, to develop that kind of a knowledge and, you know, get it into your daily living as well at the same time, you know. But a lot of people ask question ki how it is relevant or why it is not relevant, and then they see some Western adaptation and they see this is more convenient. See, convenience is a good thing, but it doesn't mean ki it comes with such a high price. Like, we are already having, you know, change in climate and all, which is affecting the overall thing, you know, in a different manner. I'm talking in a different context, but yeah, you should not wait and you should go right now.
I think I second you on that, with the other. Yeah. So are we looking at any other questions from the audiences? Santosh, there's a lot of background noise from your end.
One second. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
Akhil, we can end.
Okay. So thank you very much, Santosh, Nakul, and Vidyadhar, for taking us through the story of your calling. And thank you especially for thinking of the farmers, the hands that feed us, and trying to make their life slightly better and slightly less dangerous while they do their duty of feeding a humongous nation.
Thank you. Actually, Ankana has a question of how people can reach out to us. You can visit our website, earthentunes.in, where we are also trying to sell our shoes. Yes, earthentunes.in. Most of the details are there. You can also write to us at contact@earthentunes.in. So we are available for most of the time. We'll be happy to answer your questions. Yes.
Yeah. With this, we come to the end of today's Design Stories session with the founders of Earth & Dunes. We thank all the participants for attending today's Design Stories webinar with ADI Hyderabad, and we hope you have had some interesting takeaways from this session. For access to a year-long engagement of more such invigorating talks, webinars, and live events about the various facets of design, please become a member of ADI. If you're not an ADI member yet, do visit our website, www.adi.org.in, and become a member today. Our student membership costs just rupees 500, the link to which is in the description below. Until the next edition of Design Stories, goodbye and stay safe. Thank you, guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone.